Thank you, worship team. It's good to be in church this morning. How many of you are glad you came to church today already? Welcome, and it's good to have all of you here with us. It's also good to have those of you who are joining with us online. Just thank you for being here. I am not Pastor Chris. You're saying, who is the guy with hair up there speaking today? Now, sorry, Pastor Chris, you're probably watching online. My apologies. Pastor Chris and his family are on vacation, and so just continue to pray for them, especially during their vacation, that they can just have a relaxing and enjoyable time, that they would be refreshed and encouraged as they are together as a family, and they are visiting other extended family members. Today we're going to start a new series on prayer, and we're going to talk about this morning a very dangerous prayer. I think oftentimes that we pray safe prayers, particularly in this part of the world, in the United States. You know, we have a tendency of praying prayers like God bless us, God encourage us, God take care of us, God help us, God protect us, and all those things are good, but they're all very safe prayers to pray. And so today we're going to look at a prayer that David prayed in Psalm 139, and it's a very dangerous prayer. David prayed this after his enemies, and actually God's enemies, were on the attack, and they were accusing David of wrong motives. And so instead of David getting defensive, David actually went to the Lord and he prayed this prayer. It's found in verses 23 and 24. He prayed this: "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." A very dangerous prayer to pray. It's on the screen. Why don't you pray it with me right now? Let's say these words together. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. So in order to digest these two verses, and there's a lot to take in, we're going to break it up into four subparts and look at each part and then how that a part would apply to our life. So the first part of these two verses, David says this: search my heart. He says it very directly: search me, God, and know my heart. And for some of you, you're thinking, well, doesn't God know everything, you know? Doesn't God know our heart? And besides, you know, why would he need to pray that? I mean, generally, I have a pretty good heart. A lot of the people that I know, they have pretty good hearts. Why in the world would David pray a prayer like that? Actually, we need to understand that without Christ, we don't have a good heart. That's the first thing we need to understand. You know, we like to say, oh, she's a nice person. Oh, I like that guy. Yeah, they have good hearts. Do they really? Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 9. It says this: the human heart is the most deceitful of all things. What is it? It is desperately wicked, right? We need to understand that without Christ in our lives, without Christ doing his work in our hearts, our heart is not a good heart. The human condition of the human heart is very deceitful. And we can deceive ourselves. We can lie to ourselves, and maybe we're not even aware of it. You know, we say things like, I don't need much in this life. I just need to have my bare basic needs met, and I'll be happy. And then we see this nice car driving by, and we're going, oh, man, I wish I had that car, right? Oh, I wish I wasn't driving this bucket of bolts that I've been driving for years and years and years. God, give me that car. I claim it in Jesus' name, right? Yeah, like nobody's ever done that here or had those thoughts. Maybe we say, I don't have an issue with pride. I just can't help it that I'm better than everybody else around me. Or I don't lust. I just appreciate a nice, fine physique. I'm not into material things. I'm not materialistic at all. I just like nice things. That's just who I am. I, you know, as if other people don't like nice things, right? No, I like the stuff that's junk. Yeah, that's what I like. I'm not a gossip. I just am telling people so that they can pray about those other people that both of us know that are doing these bad things. but I'm not a gossip. Heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, and we can end up lying to ourselves. We can deceive even ourselves. So this is why this is a very dangerous prayer. Search me, O God. Show me what's in there. Show me the wickedness of my own heart. There was a time in my life when I was running from God. And just to give you some background, if you don't know my personal story, my grandfather was a pastor. He planted a church and pastored that church for years and years and years. And my mom was the choir director. My dad was the superintendent of Sunday school back in the days when we had Sunday school every Sunday morning. My mom was the organist. My mom was the pianist, depending on what they needed at one certain, you know, service. And we went to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Like, it wasn't an option. Do you want to choose Sunday night or do you want to choose Wednesday? No, we went to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. I grew up in church since I was 2 weeks old. Since I was able to, since my mom brought me there and my dad brought me there, I was in church. And so growing up that way, I learned how to act. Okay, I learned what it was, I say the good, bad, and the ugly, okay? I learned what it was like to be a Christian, okay? And if I wanted to be a good Christian, then I knew exactly how I needed to talk, how I needed to present myself, because I knew what a good Christian should look like and should be like. And what I was doing, and I didn't realize this at the time, but I became really good at faking it. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Where your heart's not in it, but you know how to present yourself a certain way, and so you do. And so around Christians, I became the Christian guy, right? Around my party friends, I was another type of guy. Around my athlete friends, I was another guy. And around my band friends, I was another guy. And so I was really good at being this guy here, and then this guy over here, and this guy over here, and this guy over here. I became very adept at faking it. But then one day, one particular day, in a moment in time, God got my attention, and I realized my sinfulness. I became aware of my sinfulness, and I became aware of truly my need for God in my life. And I remember being drawn to God. And I remember saying, God, I just don't want to live this way anymore. How many of you know it is very difficult to fake it all the time? I don't know if you understand this, but there's a lot of energy that goes into all that, okay? It's just a lot better just to be real. And that's what I love about Ridgewood, and that's what I love about the authentic Christian life. Let's just be real. Let's just be who we are, you know. Let's realize that none of us are perfect. We're not. We have issues. And if we will just come clean and be real, then God has something to work with. If we are presenting ourselves as someone that we're not, then God doesn't even have, God can't even get in there because we want something other than who we really are. We have to allow God into the space of our lives. And what is important is to say, God, search my heart. And that's what I did one day. I just said, God, shine your spotlight on my life. I don't want to live this way. I want to change. God, I want to live for you. And the reason this is a very dangerous prayer is because God will show you things that are not pure and not right in your life. You pray that prayer and you mean it, and God's going to show you those things. And it's not like God gets his jollies out of being up there in heaven and saying, oh, you're a bad person. Look, you did this and you did that. And he loves pointing out all these areas where we fall short. It's not like God is like that. But God is pointing out these areas in our life because he wants us to become conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. We are on a journey, and God desires to work within us day by day to lead us into that place where we are becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. His Holy Spirit literally transforms our life to be something much more spiritual and much more godly. That's his desire for all of our lives. He wants to draw you closer to himself, and for me as well. So David prayed this, search my heart. And then he essentially prays this, reveal my fears. Verse 23, search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know what? Know my anxious thoughts. This morning, what is it that makes you anxious? Know my anxious thoughts. I think oftentimes we don't even acknowledge our anxious thoughts. We think that, well, what we think, other people think too, and I'm just kind of like everybody else or whatever. And oftentimes anxiety and anxious thoughts are rooted in fear. What are you afraid of? I'm not talking about snakes and spiders. The tiny little things that crawl on our floor that I always have to save Jana from all the time because she can't seem to make it from one room to the other if there's a little spider in the way. And so, Mark, come in, there's a spider. I have to come in as the man of the house and say, okay, Jana, spider's gone. You can go from one room to the other because Jana is convinced the spiders can jump 9 feet in the air. They always go for your jugular vein, and it's just the way it is. But we're not talking about those kind of things. We're not talking about the guy that's behind the shower curtain when you go to the bathroom that you always have to check to make sure he's not there, right? What is it about when you're alone in the house and it's dark that you just hear more sounds than you ever do any other time? I mean, what is it about that? It just kind of happens. I don't know. Some of you are looking at me like, that doesn't ever happen to me. Our first year in marriage, we had only been married a few months, and I came home from church. I was on staff at a church in Nashville. We live in an apartment complex, and so I walked in the door, Jana, I'm home. No answer. Jana, it was only a one-bedroom apartment, but I feel like I have to call. But anyway, she's not answering, so I'm thinking, she must be down at the pool as a part of the complex. So I thought, I'm going to get something to drink, and reached over to the refrigerator, pulled the door open, and leaned in to get something to drink, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, it's like, and someone pounces on me. This was my dear, loving wife who was trying to show me affection, I guess. I don't know. Jumping off of a washing machine onto my back, thinking she wanted to greet me in that way. Then I had a phobia, like this fear of, entering into my own place, thinking, where is she? Where is she? And it's like the Pink Panther and Kato or whatever. He's going to jump out someplace, and I have to be on my guard. I had this nervous twitch. First year of marriage was heavenly bliss for me. I have survived, though. Look, I have survived. What is it that internally makes you afraid? What is it that makes you anxious? Are you afraid of losing your job? Are you afraid of not getting married by such and such of an age? Are you afraid of being stuck in the marriage that you're currently in? Are you afraid of the future, especially with the headlines that we have been seeing most recently? Are you afraid of the unknown that's in the future? A few years back, Jana and I were asked to sing at a wedding. And it was downtown, and so the kids were getting old enough to where we didn't have to hire a babysitter. So we said, Jaron, we want you to, you're old enough now, you can do this. We'd like you to watch your brother and your sister while we're gone. We'll call it sibling sitting and not babysitting or something. So Jaron was up to the task, And as we left, Jenna and Jathan were playing upstairs to themselves, and Jaron just decided that he was going to watch a movie, War of the Worlds. And if you know anything about my son, Jaron, he is Mr. Imagination, and everything that he sees, it's like, oh my goodness, really, did that happen? And he is just riveted to a television screen or a movie theater screen. And so Jaron is watching this movie and engrossed in this movie, and then all of a sudden he glances and he sees out the window that it's getting dark. And he's thinking, I need to check on my brother and my sister. So he goes upstairs, and they're not there. Where, you know, there were things, there were toys and so forth where they were playing, but they're not there. And he's like, Jenna, Jathan, calling. He doesn't hear anything. So he runs outside in the neighborhood. He's calling outside, Jenna, Jathan. They're not answering. He's going down the street, Jenna, Jathan. And he has this thought. Oh no, what if the rapture has taken place and I'm here? Oh God, forgive me, God forgive me, forgive me. And then he thinks, oh no, I'll call Dad, because I had given him my cell phone number, and if there's any problems to call me, and this was definitely a problem. And so he calls me, but I don't hear my cell phone because we're in the reception at that point, and there's music and noise and so forth, and so I don't answer. And he gets a little bit more nervous, and he thinks, oh, I'm going to try to call Pappy and Dee Dee, which is his grandfather and grandmother, and he tries to call them, and they don't answer because they're at the same reception. And he's getting a little more nervous, and then he tries to call the Beachies, his aunt and uncle and cousins, and they don't answer, and he's like, oh, no, did the rapture actually take place? And then he has this thought. Ernie and Sarah across the road, they're Christians. I'm going to go over and I'm going to knock on the door, and if they answer the door, then I'm safe. And so he knocks on the door, and who would open the door but their son that he's not sure if he's saved or not, okay? And he goes, hello? And Jaron goes, I'm looking for Ernie and Sarah. And he goes, I haven't seen them for a while. And he's like, no! And he goes running back to the house, and he goes downstairs, and he does not turn on the movie. He hits his knees, and he's crying. He's praying, oh, God, forgive me, if there's any way you can get me out of this situation. You can imagine my son, Jaron. Yeah, okay, that's it. And I noticed that I had a missed call, and I called him, and he's very upset. And I assured him that the rapture had not taken place that I know of, and that his brother and sister are safe at some people's house in the neighborhood. But quite a traumatic experience. Are you afraid of the future in any way? Are you afraid of the fact that maybe if the Lord would return, that you're not ready? How's your life? Are you afraid of failing? Some people are afraid of succeeding. What about loss? Are you afraid of loss, losing somebody, or losing something that is near and dear to your heart and of significant value to you? Why does this matter? God, show me my anxious thoughts. Because if you're taking notes this morning, you can jot this down. What we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least. Because what we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least. So if I'm scared to death that my marriage is not going to work, well, I'm not trusting God with my marriage, am I? If I'm afraid that I'm not going to be able to pay my bills and I'm overly anxious about that, am I really trusting God to be the provider in my life? What we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least. So we pray, God, reveal my fears, test me, show me where my anxious thoughts lie. And as I was praying about these scriptures, and I was preparing for this message, I prayed that prayer. God, search my heart, test me, show me, reveal to me where my anxious thoughts lie. Show me where I'm fearful. Show me where there is anxiety in my life. And I just felt like God showed me this, that oftentimes, I'm afraid of failing. If I succeed, it's not so much because I succeed, it's because I didn't want to fail. And there's a difference between the two. And it's not just failing. It's like it's letting people down. It's a fear of being inadequate. It's a fear of being not good enough, maybe not righteous enough, not wise enough. not whatever enough. You can fill in the blank. This is, I think, the fear that, anyway, it's the fear that the Lord pointed out to me. It's something that I have to work on. And this is a real issue because as a pastor, even, and just as a person, I mean, you don't want to be driven by fear in any way, right? We want to be driven by faith. We want to be led by faith. The Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please God. And many times I think when we have a fear, it keeps us from being obedient, or at least it keeps us from being obedient quickly. We have a hesitation we have to work through, and we don't want to obey God because obedience is all about faith, right? And so I was praying through that this week, and I had this thought. I have to love pleasing God more than I love failing. I have to love pleasing Him and being obedient to Him more than I love failing. And so I was thinking about this. A couple of scriptures came to mind. First one is perfect love casts out all fear. Maybe that's for you this morning. Another one that came to mind is God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And so today and this week, as you pray the prayer, search my heart, O God, test me and know my anxious thoughts. As you pray that prayer and as you really mean it, I believe what happens is we become open to God's working through the Holy Spirit in our lives. And as we become open to the Holy Spirit's working in our lives, then God shines His spotlight in our heart and we see the root of the problem. And we can begin to deal with that with God's help. It'll take a step of faith. It'll take going in the right direction with the Lord. It'll take us doing what God is calling us to do. So when you pray this, be ready, because God will reveal some things to you about yourself that maybe quite possibly you have not dealt with for many, many, many years because you didn't want to address it. You didn't want to acknowledge these things. And we kind of have a tendency of just kind of going through life thinking, well, I've hit some bumps in the road, but life's generally okay. And we keep going on this track and we think these issues are side issues or maybe they're surface issues when they're really not. And God's wanting us to address them, but we kind of just keep motoring on and it never really gets addressed. And so when you pray prayers like this and you really mean it and say, God, come and show me, reveal these things to me, God is doing that so that we can work on it through the power of the Holy Spirit and through His Word to be able to overcome these areas. Because what God is trying to do is He is trying to get us in the position where we can be transformed spiritually and we can, with greater and greater capacity, be conformed to the image of His Son, Jesus Christ. That's what God is trying to do in our lives. And so that's why He will point out needs that we have. See, our needs reveal something. Our needs reveal that we have need of a Savior. Our needs, our needs here in this life that we struggle with point us to the fact that we need Jesus Christ in our life each and every day. It's not so much about, well, one day 20 years ago, you know, I went forward and I committed my life to Christ and now I'm a Christian and that's it. You know, we have a tendency of thinking, I'm a Christian, and we go back to that time when we made that commitment. And that's good, and that's significant, and that's wonderful. But God is saying, from that point on, I want to continually work in you to cause you to be more like Christ. How many of you know, when you committed your life to Christ, there was still some baggage in your life? There were still some things that you had to work through, right? And let me say this, there are things that you have to work through today, am I wrong? And there are things that you are going to have to work through tomorrow. Am I wrong? But God's Holy Spirit and His grace is there available to us. And so in a message like this, in a prayer like this, what we're talking about is we're saying, God, I invite you into my life so that I can become all that you want me to become. And I can move towards that trajectory and I can focus myself in that direction. Let's look at number three. And this is where it becomes just a little bit more difficult. David prayed this prayer, and it has to do with uncovering our sins. David, I love it that he has the courage to pray this prayer, but he says, see if there is any offensive way in me, You know, show me, God, if there is anything in my life that is inconsistent with the truth of your word. God, show me if there's anything in my life that is displeasing to you. See if there is any offensive way in me, because I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but it's very difficult to see our sins in the mirror, isn't it? I mean, we're really good at accusing other people of sin that's in their life, but excusing our sin that's in our life. It's like if you're in traffic, and this happened to me the other day, so I can use this as an example. There was some accident or something, and we are backed up in traffic, right? And nobody is moving. And it's a standstill. Don't you love those times? Yes, it's wonderful times for the Lord to work his will in your life. Great times to rely on the Lord. Stress level goes up here. And so, and I'm sitting there in traffic and not moving at all, and I'm seeing this car way back, it seemed like a quarter of a mile back, come out of the line, go on the right shoulder of the road, and gradually work his way up. Have you ever seen that before? How does that make you feel? As if my time's not important? His time is more important than me? I mean, is he more special than I am? Why does he get to go on the right shoulder of the road and go all the way up? And what is the thought that you... Now, I'm confessing here, but maybe you've had the same thought. You know what I wanted to do? When he was a couple of cars behind me, just pull out and block him right there. Anyone else ever had that thought before? Just passing through your mind? Yeah. I didn't do that, because I didn't want to get in an accident. But isn't it interesting how we, and then we start to make judgments about this guy and his character and all this, and, you know, we start to mutter and we, all these things go in our mind, right? We fill our mind with all these things. But then maybe a day or two later, guess who's doing that very same thing? When you're in a rush. Well, and we have a tendency of excusing it because, well, my boss is going to be mad at me if I'm late, or if I have to do this, you know. We can think up of a million excuses why it's okay for us, but it's not okay for someone else. The heart is deceitful above all things, and the most common lies are the ones that we tell ourselves. And that's why it takes tremendous courage to say, God, search my heart and test me and know my anxious thoughts and see if there is any offensive way in me. This can be one of the most game-changing prayers you'll ever pray in your life, because you are giving God permission to point out any sin that is dwelling in your heart. We can play church and we can say, oh, that's not me. I don't have sin dwelling in my heart. I'd like to give you three questions that might be helpful as you're praying, God, uncover sins in my life. And sometimes when you're in prayer and you're asking God this question in prayer, sometimes God will whisper to you, he'll speak to you and say, this is what you need to do. You need to do this. And you need to go to this person, or you need to, you know, and God will show you and God will direct you and speak to you. Still small voice. Sometimes God uses other people to speak into your life. Now, we don't like to hear that as much as we, oh, God, just speak to me directly, me and you, me and you. But God has designed it that our spiritual growth, part of the capacity of growth for us spiritually, is that we would do that with a community of faith, of brothers and sisters. That's why we're all here together today, you know? And brothers and sisters in Christ, people that really love us, can help us in our journey of faith. Because it's not just God and me. It's God and me and others. And if there are people that are in your life, maybe three or four people, and they are saying the exact same thing to you. I just have a concern about you in this area, or I'm wondering if you have a problem in this area, and you know that those people are people that consistently love you, that they have a pure heart in this. It might be it just might be that God is using them to speak to you. And we need to be aware of that. The second question that I think we need to ask ourselves is, have I rationalized some things for some time? Just kind of rationalize it away. I know that there's this area that's not quite just right, but you know what? It's really not that big of a deal, and so we really don't deal with it. We rationalize it away. We say, you know what? It's nobody's business really anyway, or, if I'm doing this, I'm really not hurting anybody, as if then we say, well, then we think that then it's okay because we're not hurting anybody. We don't think that we're hurting anybody, and so we rationalize it away. We think it's not that big of a deal. It could be that if God reveals that to you, that that's an area you need to address. The third thing is, where am I most defensive? You know, maybe one of those people, the three or four that we talked about, comes to you and they are reiterating and they are reinforcing what someone else has said to you and so forth. And they'll say, you know what, I really feel like as I was in prayer, God brought you to my mind, and I just really feel like God wants me to say this to you. And so they tell you, do you have a problem in this area? And you're like, whoa, problem? I mean, you're telling me about a problem let me tell you about the problems that are in your life, I could see a bunch of problems in your life. You're telling me about one, I can give you 10, okay? And we get all defensive. Why are we getting defensive? Could it be that that's an area of sin that we need to deal with? When you have the courage to pray this prayer, see if there is any offensive way in me, God is going to point some things out to you that maybe you've been trying to explain away for a long time. God will point some things out to you that quite possibly you've been trying to deny, but they're nonetheless there. Because here's the truth. Denying the truth does not make truth false. Just because we deny, it might make us feel better for a period of time, but it doesn't mean that it's false. Maybe God is saying to you, have the courage, pray this prayer, and when it comes to light, let's confess it and let's get on board and let's deal with it. Quite possibly, God might be saying that. And right now, in these moments, quite possibly, God might be speaking to you about something right now, in these moments. I would just encourage you to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit and to obey Him. You know, there are different types of confession, too. There's the confession to God, and then we confess to people. The Bible says we confess to God for the forgiveness of our sins. The Bible says we confess to people for healing. What are the scriptures here? 1 John 1:9, we all know it. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But also, there's another scripture that says, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other that you may be what? Healed. There's healing that is involved when sins are confessed to one another. There's a lot of things that are involved. There's humility that can be involved. There are other things that God can work in our life. We confess to God for forgiveness, and we can confess to people for healing. And that's why, one of the reasons why, life groups, we put a value on life groups and why they're so important. Because when you are in a group, a community of faith, a group of people who love you and are genuinely concerned about your welfare and want to see you grow spiritually, and you come into that group, maybe you're new, and you have to gain trust and so forth. You might be a little apprehensive. But you hear someone share a struggle that they have, and then someone else shares a struggle here, and you're like, well, wait, I saw them in church, and I thought they had it all together. No, they don't have it all together. None of us have it all together, right? Well, I thought they were near perfect. Well, no, they're going through some issues. And then you feel that because they're sharing their story, that you can share your struggle as well, because you feel like you have the support mechanism that is there, people that are going to support you, they're going to pray for you, they're going to encourage you, and they have God's best for you in their mind while they're doing it. And that's why life groups are so vitally important. That's not something we can do here on a Sunday morning. But sharing life together in a community of faith is part of growth in the Christian life. Sometimes we can be all about gaining knowledge. You know, share with me the insight in this scripture and all that, and that's good. That's well and good. But there comes a time when we need to flesh out His word in our life and begin to walk it out. And other people can help us do that. It's just not a me and God thing all the time. We need others in our life. We need others to help us. We need others to encourage us. We need to open up and share. And as we do, as we open up and share, they can believe with us. They can trust God with us. They can encourage us. And we understand that we're all in a process moving toward what God would have for all of us as we grow in Him, as we grow in His grace, as we grow in His mercy, and as truthfully we grow in His word. Because the word of God that you really, 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 really know is the word of God that you're walking out in your life on a daily basis. The word of God that you're not walking out in your life on a daily basis, it can have a tendency to become a lot of head knowledge. But the spiritual life isn't just about head knowledge. The spiritual life is about life transformation. And that's what God wants for each and every part of our lives. The word of God being made real in our lives as we live the life that is truly a Christian, that we are real people in a community of faith. You know, we have a tendency of thinking that, you know, we all put our best foot forward and we all try to present ourselves like we're a good Christian, and we all try to be kind of perfect when we gather together. We want everybody else to know that we're doing a good job in this Christian walk and so forth. And let me just say this. If you feel like you're a perfect person, this church isn't the place for you. We are a bunch of imperfect people who serve a perfect God. Amen. Who are relying on Him to change us and cause us to be transformed in His image. We are a community of faith that is on a journey toward that end. And sometimes it can get a little messy in the process. And we need to be okay with that. Because God is working His will and accomplishing His purpose in us. Band, if you'd come up at this time as we prepare to continue to worship the Lord. You know, I shared with you my struggle and my issue in terms of not fully trusting God, in terms of feeling inadequate, in terms of failing. And as I was thinking about this and processing this, you know, it's kind of rooted in more of an approval for people instead of, you know, approval of God. That's really what I need to be seeking after in my life. But I was thinking about this, and I said this earlier, but this really hit home for me. When I understand that I have a need in my life and I see that need, whenever I see that need, it just reinforces the fact that God is working in this process to show me what that need is, and I recognize that that shows that I need Christ in my life. So I always need Christ in my life. Every day I need to depend upon Him. Every day, because I have needs, I need a Savior. Because I have needs, I need someone who loves me more than anyone else could ever possibly imagine. And the same is true for you today. As God is sharing this with you and you recognize possibly this morning that you have needs, let me tell you, that's just pointing toward your need for Christ on a daily basis. You might say, I'm addicted. Well, you need His power to overcome your addiction. You might say, I have a struggle with pride issues. You need His power to be humbled and to depend on Him. Maybe you say, I'm dealing with lust and I just can't seem to get over it. I mean, you need His truth to renew your mind and to transform your heart. That's what you need. I mean, we could try to do as much as we could try to do on our own, and it's always going to fall short because God has designed us that we don't have the capacity to do this alone. Maybe you say, I'm materialistic, I just love the things of this world. Well, you need to love God more than you love the things of this world. And as you do, He transforms your heart's desire. It's a dangerous prayer, and it takes courage to pray. And there are some things that we're going to discover about ourselves that, frankly, we're not going to be proud of. But there's always grace. There's always His grace that is available to us today. At the very end, David prays this prayer, and he says, lead me. When you show me what I don't like about myself, and you show me what needs to be changed, now lead me in the way everlasting. He says, see if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Search me, O God. You have permission to look deep into the depths of my deceitful heart. And show me, God, test me, reveal to me my anxious thoughts. Show me the places that I fear the most, and show me the places that I trust You the least. You know, I used to think that, when we came to Christ, we had all these big things in our life, and then God would just take care of these big things, and it's great. And then the longer you journey with Christ, the more you understand that there are all these little things that keep cropping up that we have to deal with, all these things that are a part of our life that we just always have to try to trust God and ask Him to help us with. And you know what I found over the years? There are no little things in God. They're all big things. If He's speaking to you, it's a big thing. We might think relativity, not God. He says, I want you to work on this now. Okay, good, I want you to work on this now. All right, we're doing pretty well. Let's do this. And it's a continual journey with Him, but we have His grace and we have His help. Lord, we need Your help, and we call upon You right now to do what we cannot do. Jesus, we need Your power. Jesus, we need Your grace. Lord, we need Your freedom. We need our identity to be found completely in You. Lord, help us to live for an audience of one, not to live for ourselves, not to live for anybody else but You, knowing that we are Christ and Christ alone. God, we pray that You would transform us into the people that You desire for us to be. Conform us to the image of Jesus Christ, we pray. Before the band comes and sings and we worship together, let's pray Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24 together. And I just encourage you, make this a prayer that comes from your heart. Really mean this to the Lord right now. Let's pray together. Search me, God. Know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting.